This session is properly titled. It's somewhat abbreviated in the book, and I hope this is not going to disturb you when you see the real title. But it was too long for the pamphlet, so you're looking at Afro-Americans in U.S. Foreign Policy, but properly titled, it's Anti-Communism and the Afro-American Struggle to Influence U.S. Foreign Policy, which narrows and I think sharpens the focus somewhat. There are three of us who are going to be participating. To just let you have the format, we want half of the time to be spent as close as possible in exchange with you and discussion with the audience, so that my presentation, of course, I'm Angela Gilliam, which is entitled The Soviet Expansionism Thesis or the Pro-Slavery Argument Revisited. We then have Gerald Horne, who is on my right, who is going to be discussing Afro-Americans and the relationship to the Cold War. And to my left is Jack O'Dell, who many of you may have heard yesterday, and also who will be our discussant this afternoon. You will notice that on the program it says Manuel Pedro Pacavira, who is the current ambassador to the United Nations from Angola. He unfortunately had to go off to Geneva for a meeting on precisely this subject of the agreement that hopefully is going to bring about Namibian independence as one of the byproducts, the presumed agreement amongst the three or four states, Cuba, Angola, and South Africa, with the United States as cheerleader, I suppose. Nonetheless, that's the reason why he couldn't be here. So after all three of us have our presentation, we'll then just open it up to questions, okay? So we're going to try to stick to this time frame, and I brought along a little clock so that we could all use it. And so we're going to start now. Now, I would like to start out with a quote that I think is very interesting because it establishes an interesting frame of reference. And quote, with his political friends, his will was law. The opposing political party were comparatively few in numbers. They feared his power, and no member of either Senate or House of Representatives appeared willing to expose the great moral crimes which the government was committing against humanity. Hence, Congress granted whatever supplies were demanded for carrying on this piratical war and enabling the president to slay those who refused to be enslaved. End of quote. Ever since the 19th century, wealthy U.S. interests have been rationalizing the drives for freedom and liberty among the poor or slave as merely the reflection of outside agitation. Similarly, there's been a constant interpretation by the government that solidarity in practice along ethnic lines is inimical to the state. In the 19th century, this meant an unremitting drive to eliminate the Seminole support to fugitive slaves in Florida, for example. That campaign was to elevate racist Andrew Jackson to the presidency, and about whom the above-cited quotation is written. And I thought that quotation sounded so much like Ronald Reagan, I couldn't resist putting it in. In the 20th century, there is the indiscriminate labeling as communist, quote unquote, any people who advocate egalitarianism and non-racialism for themselves or for humanity at large. Thus, civil rights activists and leaders have been the targets of repression and murder. Their inspiration to action was routinely attributed to outside agitation, whether from the North in the 19th century or even England, as we shall see, or in the 20th century, primarily from Moscow. This process has become progressively consolidated, so much so that in the 1980s, there's been a total merger of the South African regime's agenda with that of the United States government. Throughout its 200-year history, the U.S. people, the U.S. as a country, has been in the struggle to open the doors to this society, to make freedom accessible to all who lived there. Native Americans, new immigrants, slave, and poor white have knocked at the door of the nation. Yet this country is in the process of deliberately closing its doors to those yearning for equality through any number of ruses. As the American counter-revolution becomes more consolidated, it becomes more racist, sexist, and ungenerous. The tragedy of the recent elections is that many U.S. women accepted their supposed inferiority by voting for an openly inegalitarian platform. That is the Republican Party platform. Women acknowledge doubts about their abilities to function and make decisions on an equal par with men. Now, my contention is that there is a historical rationale for this situation, and I believe that the roots to the 1980s lie in the fact that the Southern planter ideology, which was so powerful in the Congress in the 19th century, was not cleansed from the nation following the Civil War. This has meant periodic reversals in the gains toward equality made by citizens. The first such reversal occurred with the defeat of the Reconstruction era, and I would recommend everybody to read that magnum opus by Eric Foner called Reconstruction. And this period has been routinely depicted in U.S. textbooks as a quote-unquote black page of U.S. history rather than as the beginning of democratic promise. Similarities between the first post-Reconstruction period and the current Reagan-Bush era are compelling. Most startling are the similarities in argument between anti-abolitionist forces who attributed the desire for freedom among the slaves to outside agitation and the contemporary anti-communists who see Soviet manipulation in every cry for equality in today's world. Thus, the Soviet expansionism thesis is the operationalization of racism in the modern period. And of course, the rising popularity of many of these attitudes has been engineered in the major media. Not only are the most retrogressive views given credence by their presentation, but indeed the definitions of right and left are beginning to lose traditional meaning. Thus, the US media has become an unwitting arm of the state in that it reproduces the ideology of the government and the military. The assertions by people of their right to equality and a share in the land, resources, or power is eventually dismissed as communist-inspired. By believing in the sanctity and so-called freedom of the press, some U.S. citizens are willfully participating in their own ignorance. Furthermore, when the world's peoples have declared that they have a right to define their situations, their struggles, and themselves in the media as well, these demands have been lumped under the rubric of attacks to freedom of the press. This was the true significance of the U.S. government's attempts to destroy UNESCO and the UN system. I think that there is a way for the American revolutionary impulse to be renewed in the United States, and that is for the contemporary equivalents to the abolition and American anti-slavery society to reemerge with vigor. It too must be non-racial in composition and egalitarian in focus. Such a movement must be even more international in theory and practice, and I believe it can only come about by a merger of the anti-apartheid and peace movements worldwide. The fight against apartheid is central to any significant attack on racialism in the United States, and it is also central to the whole framing of the situation in East-West terms that anti-communists have defined. The inheritors of the pro-slavery opposition to emancipation will label this merger a threat to freedom and democracy, and some of the reasons for this are in the 19th century. Now, Joshua Giddings, 19th century abolitionist who served in the House of Representatives, gives ample testimony to the power of pro-slavery forces in Congress. He states succinctly, and then this was a book published originally in 1859, quote, "It was known that the slaveholders controlled the action of the House, and they showed no courtesy to those who opposed the peculiar institution," as slavery was called. Indeed, according to Giddings, 1848 was the first year in which the records of the nation show a minority report from any committee in Congress against slavery. And I recommend you all look up the gag rule, which said that, of course, there could be no discussion of this brought up at all to Congress. It is interesting to note that Giddings himself was called to testify before Congress in an anti-abolitionist McCarthy-like inquisition led by Southern Senator Mason following the hanging of anti-slavery militant John Brown in 1859. The pro-slavery forces were not restricted to the South, and many Northerners were totally convinced that slavery was the natural order of things in the nation. Indeed, this view was reproduced in many Northern newspapers, which were to fan the flames of anti-black sentiment after emancipation. These predecessors of today's major media, quote, warned against an inundation of newly freed blacks, increasing public antipathy, close quote. Indeed, the feelings of some Northerners could be represented by one of them, one Reverend Colton, who affirmed in an 1839 act of Congress that abolition was a religious sect and political movement which was antithetical to Christianity. In his attack on the American Anti-Slavery Society, he said that this organization had, quote, a state machinery, was a political organization aimed by the use of political agencies and powers at a radical and great change in the American political fabric, close quote. Colton used every verbal ruse to demonstrate that abolitionists sought to, quote, overthrow the government as it now exists and therefore was a seditious organization. And it's interesting that that Colton felt that the principles of abolitionism were based on anarchy and lawlessness because, and again I quote, they have leveled all distinctions in society of rank, color, caste, and sex. Here then was the true problem, which was across the board egalitarianism as advocated by abolitionists. Colton was also to use other pro-slavery rationales that would one day find themselves modified and used by the South African regime and its allies. Quote, there they will see that it is better to be a slave in America than a free man in Africa, that the best conditions of African barbarism could never be envied by the worst of American slavery. Many of you remember the Adolf Coors assertion, pretty much to the same effect that many blacks, the reason for which many blacks later boycotted Coors. Another of Colton's thoughts that suggest that the notions of freedom among blacks owe their presence to outside agitations is this one. And Colton was very representative of the period. Abolitionism has created a very unpleasant state of feeling in the minds of the free colored population and made them unhappy. It has vitiated their domestic and social character as servants. It has invested them with an importance in their own esteem, which the present state of society is not prepared to reward them. Other pro-slavery advocates said similar things, such as Henry Field James, who saw abolition as an ever-growing fanaticism, and he stated as quotes, with slavery I have been conversant all my life, nursed by slaves and reared in their midst. I knew them well before abolition was introduced. I know them now since its baneful influence has been felt. Look at the African slave in his native simplicity before this wily serpent had crept in to mar his peace and happiness, and what do we behold? A dependent and faithful creator looking up to his master as his best friend and protector. Thus the reader can see that foreign policy towards black nations also has an ideological heritage in Southern planter ideology, because that previous quote, writ large, is American foreign policy towards the Third World. Not only were the abolitionists introducing untenable thoughts of freedom into the brains of slaves, but James is one anti-abolitionist who was one of the first to ascribe the origins of the desires for freedom to foreign influence. Quote, it will be perceived that the excitement in the U.S. is ascribed to foreign influence. Sundry facts in the knowledge of the author have forced, though reluctantly, to that conclusion. In this case, James was referring to England. I want to rush through here because I want to get to the conclusion. Let me just go to Thomas Dixon, who, of course, his novel, The Klansman, cannot be underestimated for its importance as representing Reconstruction or post-Reconstruction views. His novel, The Klansman, was to be made into an epic film, The Birth of a Nation, a film which is important to study for its racism as much as the so-called cinematic breakthroughs. And I challenge everyone in the audience to go look up this film, any book about Birth of a Nation. Very few address the question of the racism. They concentrate on the technological breakthrough of the cast of thousands, okay? This picture depicts the dark days of Reconstruction, the heroism of the Ku Klux Klan in, quote, saving white civilization and white women from newly freed savages, close quote. The saving of white civilization was to become the battle cry of apartheid South Africa, just as it fueled the Ku Klux Klan formed in 1867. Dixon expressed the same idea in previous work called The Leopard Spots, A Romance of the White Man's Burden, 1865 to 1900. In that novel, there's the almost prophetic vision of the Armageddon notion, which is, of course, the religious rights battle cry. This is a white man's government conceived by white men and maintained by white men through every year of its history, and by the God of our fathers, it shall be ruled by white men until the archangel shall call the end of time. I think what's interesting is that Woodrow, the president at the time, for example, Birth of a Nation, came out, said that the movie was like writing history with lightning, and my only regret is that it is also terribly true. I think in Angela Davis's landmark work, she demonstrates that this myth of bipolar myth of the need to protect white womanhood and the rise of black rapists and mulattoes whose major goal after emancipation is to marry white women, that this merges, it satisfies two things. One, it isolates women, white women, from any type of vote, which is what they were also often in the abolitionist movement for, trying to get the vote, that is middle class white women. And it also merged several goals at the same time. The problem is, I think, in contemporary American society is that the struggle against racism has not been central to the women's movement. This division that starts right after the end of Reconstruction separates the middle-class white women from the struggles against racism, and that is one of the unresolved contradictions of Reconstruction that we're still living with. So that this ideology sets the stage for the arrival to the U.S. of millions of immigrants searching for a new life, adopting racism as the way to become American. Let me just go very quickly here to a conclusion. So I have about 5 minutes, 3 minutes. Now, what stands in the way of our merging this struggle of anti-communism and racism? One is that I think the centrality of the historical merger of racism with pro-slavery ideology has not been recognized by many forces that attempt to measure this. The effect of all of this on the Afro-American community is that it has, in a sense, not been able to organize to make a statement as a group on U.S. foreign policy directly, but it has made a statement indirectly. With the exception of the anti-apartheid movement, the hierarchization, that is that foreign policy is properly the exclusive purview of white males, has remained steadfast. The appearance on the scene of Jesse Jackson, who pretends to define foreign policy as the natural arena of the struggle against racism, has produced a furious struggle within U.S. ruling class circles. He is not alone amongst Afro-Americans who see this. One can see that the recent election statistics bear this out. For example, there were two interesting election campaigns with black Republicans running, one in Virginia, one in Maryland. Alan Keyes, and these are two states that for the first time since God knows when, went Republican, okay? And William Sapphire of the New York Times is very hopeful that black people would vote one of their own, that's his words, at least a third, and that Alan Keyes would be put over. What did we have? 37% of the Republicans, though the state went Republican, 37% of the Republicans voted for Keyes, 14% of blacks voted for Keyes, and Dawkins in Virginia, whose major role was to take Jonas Savimbi of UNITA around to black churches throughout the South, okay? He won the lowest. He got 9% of the black vote. Now, there are several questions. This, on one hand, is very exciting because it shows if there's any tribalism, it was not amongst black people. They voted their class interests. If those two states went Republican, why couldn't their black candidates piggyback, right? So that this is, in a sense, sophistication, I believe, that is often unrecognized on the part of black voters. But there are other problems, I think, that get us into this problem of why black people do not, or how black people affect this question of foreign policy. And there are four points that I wanted to mention. Basically, the allies of the Afro-American community, often on the left, and I think this conference is a sign of this problem, do not recognize the centrality of racism to the discussion of anti-communism. Okay? Second, our international allies, that is, people who would seem to have a natural constituency in the amongst Afro-Americans, often from progressive countries or progressive black countries, make little sustained attempt to reach out to the Afro-American community and often act as though they had accepted the US ruling class's sociometric definition of blacks as less important, quote unquote. And of course, if you lived in New York, there were lots of talks about people who don't go north of 90th Street or 59th Street. Many Afro-Americans themselves, either fraught with self-doubt or the struggle to survive, reproduce an identification with this situation. And there are two other points that I just wanted to mention before I close, saying that I think that the that we have to be very clear that anti-communism is an absolute, has critical impact on the black community, but they've managed to stand fast in spite of not having the information. And this case with Dawkins, I think, is a clear Dawkins and Keys. And we can talk about those two perhaps later with more detail. The other thing is that we, and I wish that the panel on religion had gone into how working class, especially working class black people, are influenced by the religious right. Listen to this Channel 20 or Channel 47 or whatever, that PTL stuff, day in and day out. The allegiance to the church experience as a source of sustenance has a double-edged sword. On one hand, you've got the Jackson type of Christianity, and on the other hand, you do have groups of people going, for example, to make pilgrimages to Israel, support the Israeli government policies, and so on. And I think this has been underestimated or under-discussed, shall we say. There seems to be this problem in this unresolved contradiction about Reconstruction that whites see all class, or that is that the whole question is subsumed under class in an international and national sense, that is as a tendency. In a sense, this allows them to dismiss their own unresolved racial problems, and blacks have a tendency to focus on race, which allows us to then follow the Savimbis and not distinguish between the African National Congress or SWAPO and Savimbi, or to not even notice, for example, what is going on in the Pacific, or to recognize that racism also is affecting the Irish people, that aspects of racism affects Irish. So we have not had a national, shall we say, discussion on this question, and I think the roots are in the 19th century in this lack of cultural cleansing after Reconstruction, and until we indeed, as Jack O'Dell I'm sure will say, confront our origins as a nation built on genocide, then we're really not going to address anti-communism in any serious way. Thank you. I'd like to ask Joe.
Thank you very much, and also thanks to the organizers for inviting me to be a part of this panel and for organizing this conference in general. Let me first of all say that in terms of the, just for the historical record, in terms of the little snippet of a biography listed in the program, my field is not political science, but history and law. I'm not at San Diego, but Santa Barbara. And the title of this book, and is Communist Front with a question mark. I mean, Communist Front is obviously an inherently anti-communist term, and it makes me think I should have accepted the advice of my publishers not to use such a provocative title, but because you can run those risks. Let me say also that in terms of books, I think it would have been worthwhile, and perhaps we can get into this later, for the conference, I mean, it's so much to deal with, but to have dealt with some of the recent histories dealing with this subject in particular, since it's such an important subject, dealing with the merging of black and red, because I think the U.S. historical field has had a problem, which is that how can they write this glorious history of the civil rights movement? The history is obviously glorious, and it's even been sanctified to a certain extent by the having the January 15th as the Martin Luther King holiday. How can they write this glorious history while excluding the role of the left, which played such an important role? They don't want to give the left any credit for the very central role that the left played in this movement. So you've had these historians like Richard Kluger and Simple Justice, who, you know, buries his head in the sand and ignores the role of the left. Then you have like David Garrow, for example, who in the FBI and Martin Luther King book basically accepted the most crude anti-communist slanders. I mean, it's mind-boggling. Basically through the device of accepting FBI Freedom of Information documents as the gospel truth. And then in the second book, which won the Pulitzer Prize on Martin Luther King, he basically, because of the criticisms that he had received for the FBI book, basically ignored the role of the left in the second book and just didn't touch upon it at all. And then, of course, winning the Pulitzer Prize, as the Pulitzer Prize Committee acknowledged, because of these allegations about alleged sexual proclivities of King, although writers like Willie Leventhal and Claiborne Carson and myself as well have shown that this is basically poppycock. There's another point, too, which is just by way of introduction to this field, and that is that the continent of Africa basically has more progressive and socialist-oriented states than any other continent. So to the extent that Afro-Americans tend to relate, even in a vaguely nationalistic way, to the African continent, inevitably they're going to be thrown into conflict and contradiction with the primary dictates of U.S. foreign policy. And that should never be lost sight of when discussing this field of anti-communism. In any event, I'm sure it comes as no secret to most of us here that the Afro-American communities, exemplified by the campaigns of Jesse Jackson, the Congressional Black Caucus, etc., basically lies at the heart of the progressive movement of the United States. Some often say that those who feel the most pain scream the loudest. This is not a new development. Philip Foner and George Walker, in their book on the proceedings of the Black State Conventions, point this out and also point to the attention to U.S. foreign policy even in the 19th century, even before the Civil War. The revolutions in Europe in 1848 were cheered, for example. A comparison of the situations of blacks and the Irish was frequently made. Parallels were drawn between the freedom of slaves in the Americas, not just those in the United States, and the freedom of serfs in Eastern Europe. The historian Willard Gatewood has shed light on the nation anti-imperialism in the black community as the Spanish-American and the Anglo-Boer Wars were launched. The NAACP, organized in 1909, basically continued this trend. In 1910, the association devastatingly condemned the Tsar's expulsion of the Jewish people from Kiev. At a two-day conference sponsored by the NAACP in Washington in May 7, 1917, the delegates drafted resolutions attributing the cause of World War I to racism and profit-seeking. Jumping ahead to World War II, you see this trend even exemplified even more. Even though it may be hard for some to conceive today, there's no question that at the dawn of World War II, the NAACP, and I would say the Afro-American community generally, was avowedly anti-imperialist, and that was the term that was in fact used. Of course, this was facilitated to a certain extent by the fact that with the period from 1941 to 1945 in the United States in an anti-fascist alliance with the Soviet Union, this tended to undercut the basis for the main barrier to social progress, that is to say, red baiting. It was difficult to red bait when the United States itself was having its chestnuts plucked from the fire by Moscow. So this objectively helped to create the basis for social progress and for left politics. You might reference the film Mission to Moscow made by Warner Brothers during World War II, which of course Jack Warner took a lot of flack of after the Cold War began, which portrayed Stalin as a benevolent leader of his people, basically scorned Trotsky. And this was something that was not just peculiar to Warner Brothers, this was something that you could see in Time magazine and on and on and on. And certainly this did not leave the Afro-American community unaffected, because the NAACP was able to take advantage of this objective situation to push an even closer alliance with the left than it had pushed up to that point. So you see that in the period from 1940 to 1945, the NAACP membership basically went from 40,000 to 400,000, which basically where it stayed ever since. Actually, some insiders say that it's less than 400,000 today, but the official figure often is given as 400,000. Of course, Ella Baker, one of the founders of SNCC played a very prominent role during this period as the membership director of the NAACP at that time. The kind of anti-imperialism and progressive sentiments as reflected in the NAACP and the black community generally can be seen in the Declaration of Negro Voters, which was issued during the height of the war, which said, and I quote, "We are concerned that this war bring an end to imperialism and colonial exploitation. We believe that political and economic democracy must displace the present system of exploitation in Africa, the West Indies, and other colonial areas." The book, recent book by Patrick Washburn, A Question of Sedition, which looks at the black press during World War II, has some interesting evidence in this regard, not only in line with what I've already been saying, but also pointing to the sort of disaffection of the black community in terms of, well, not only in terms of fighting the anti-fascist war, but also the some blacks, not many, but some, were attracted to the siren song that the Japanese were promulgating at that time, that is to say the Japanese as the protector of the colored races. But the black community was being so militant with regard to race that the Justice Department was considering shutting down the black press in general. In any event, 1941 to 1945 should be seen as a zenith for black progress generally, as Philip Foner points out in his Organized Labor in the Black Worker book. Concomitant with that, of course, was this ongoing trend of the blacks being associated and attracted to the Communist Party. Even though some historians, such as Lauren Barrett, has said that black radicalism was slow to gather, slower even than white, racial oppression combined with economic oppression effectively submerged black Americans to a pre-political level, unquote. Despite such allegations, the fact of the matter is that you have to turn Barrett on its head to get a true representation of what was actually going on in the United States at this time. For example, it was not surprising that a Negro Digest poll in 1944 found an overwhelming majority of blacks praising the party's policies, particularly with regard to racial integration. The anti-communist political scientist Harvey Clair, in one of his earlier works, stated that by 1961, one quarter of the Central Committee members were blacks. Blacks were far less likely than whites to leave the CPUSA either by a resignation are expulsion. And then, of course, it's no accident that many of the leading intellectuals in the black community, be it W.E.B. Du Bois or Paul Robeson, or even Ralph Bunche, for that matter, were either part of the Communist Party, within the Communist Party's orbit, or somehow attracted to socialism generally. The political scientist Alfred O. Hero has confirmed some of this in some of the studies he has made, which shows that blacks, with regard to U.S. foreign policy, were definitely less anti-communist, definitely more prone to sympathize with the victims of colonial oppression more so than the colonizers themselves. And this, of course, has ever been a bone in the throat of U.S. imperialism in terms of implementing some of their more dastardly schemes. Blacks, just to tack on to what Angela was saying, if anything, we're not so much concerned whether or not you were tough on reds. They were more concerned, if anything, if you're tough on whites. And that is something, it seems to me, should not be lost sight of, even in 1988 in the days of the Rainbow Coalition. Now, the problem for the United States ever since the end of World War II has been this. How can they win hearts and minds in an increasingly colored world, particularly at the United Nations, but in other international fora as well, when people of color in the United States were being subjected to a hellish discrimination and racism? If you go back and look at the brief submitted by the State Department in the Shelley versus Kramer case that in 1948, which overturned the racist covenant and property transactions, even in Brown versus Board of Education, there's in the body of the decision itself, there is recognition that the walls of Jim Crow had to recede, if not fall, because of the dictates of U.S. foreign policy. It was becoming increasingly difficult to win these hearts and minds when people of color in this country were being subjected to discrimination. At the same time as the McCarthyite period was getting underway, and there was this effort to separate black from red, it was found that this was no easy process. One of the, going back to the historians, and this is one of the reasons why this is not widely known, one of the best kept secrets of contemporary US history is the role of the left in helping to push the civil rights movement. Not only the role of the Highlander Folk School, which of course Rosa Parks had attended before she decided on that fateful day not to go to the back of the bus. Miles Horton, who was one of the leaders of the HFS, had studied Marx, had known Du Bois since the early 1930s, and insisted that communists not be barred from another organization he had worked with, which was equally important, the Southern Conference for Human Welfare. Communists were welcome at HFS and freely participated. Many of the original leaders of the student nonviolent movements had attended HFS workshops. We Shall Overcome itself was a legacy from HFS. Horton had been associated earlier with James Dombrowski as a member of the Commonwealth College, another progressive institution which should not be lost sight of. Alden Morris, a sociologist, in his work on the civil rights movement has underscored this, although he has been a distinct minority in terms of doing so. SCEF is another organization that should not be lost sight of in terms of playing a pivotal role in the civil rights movement, as well as the Progressive Party, the last serious third-party effort, which of course was red-baited and ran aground in the election of 1948, but often lost sight of with regard to the Progressive Party and the campaign by Henry Wallace in 1948 was the very pivotal role played by blacks in this process. As Curtis McDougall, who was instrumental in forming the PP and also wrote the book Gideon's Army on it, Curtis McDougall has pointed out that it was Negro signatures that put the new party on the ballot in virtually every southern state and in other parts of the country. Negro petitioners and signers were amongst the most active. The Progressive Party nominated proportionally more Negro candidates than did the other parties, and it nominated them for offices to which Negroes had never been named by either major party. The largest number of Negro candidates ever picked to run on a single ticket since the days of Thaddeus Stevens were picked by the Progressive Party. This, of course, helped to push the Democratic Party in a progressive direction on civil rights, and therefore, as the histories have told us, now we point to Harry S. Truman, who had early in his career had an association with the Ku Klux Klan, as somehow being the leading figure in helping to bring blacks out of the field of segregation into the Democratic Party mainstream, when actually it was the threat of the Progressive Party and the fact that he thought he was about to lose to this nutcracker of Henry Wallace on the left and Thomas Dewey on the right that actually brought him in that direction. So during this whole period of McCarthyism, the problem once again for Washington was how to separate the black from the red and the red from the black. Similarly, Ann Brayton has been very correct in pointing out that the House Un-American Activities Committee basically met its Waterloo when it took its traveling roadshow to Atlanta in the late 1950s. And with that, you began to see the devolution of HUAC. That is to say that the civil rights movement as well should be given substantial credit for helping to break the back of anti-communism and McCarthyism during those dark days of the late 1950s. Now, even though the historians may not have been aware of this, those who run this country have been aware of the fact that blacks have been very closely linked with the red and have been in the forefront of the progressive movement in this country. One historian, for example, Alan Harper, mentioned that in the 11th Congressional District of Indiana, quote, 128 of 139 postal employees questioned by loyalty investigators, implementing Truman's loyalty plan, and had been blacks and Jewish. Philip Foner observes that the black tobacco workers were the first to feel the sting of the CIO's red-baiting drive, and notes that 65% of the longshoremen in the ILWU screened for the waterfront for decidedly pinkish tendencies were not white, but black. Black communists were disproportionately hit by the Red Scare. Richard Freeland records that Ferdinand Smith, who was the black communist leader of the National Maritime Union, was one of the first victims of the Justice Department's effort to deport Cold War opponents who happened to be from other countries, that is to say aliens, as the term was used. In fact, I think it's fair to say, as the writer Wayne Addison Clark said in his Duke University dissertation, that you basically had a tactical shift by ruling circles after World War II. Racism, to a certain extent, had been discredited by the unhappy experience, shall we say, of Hitlerite fascism. So you saw the Jim Crow advocates, the Stennises, the Eastlands, and of course those who happened to be the most anti-black also happened to be the most anti-red. You had a tactical shift from portraying blacks not so much as being inferior beings, but blacks as being subversive beings, and the civil rights movement as being a subversive movement and a subversive organization. You see this trend particularly portrayed in the history of the Civil Rights Congress, another organization that unfortunately has not received its due from the historians. You see particularly this merger of the black and the red with this genocide petition, the We Charge Genocide petition filed by the CRC with the United Nations, charging the United States government with massive human rights violations, particularly against its citizens of African descent, a petition basically led and promulgated by the black lawyers William Patterson and Paul Robeson. This put the United States in a particularly tricky and prickly position, because here they were talking about lack of democracy beyond the so-called Iron Curtain in Eastern Europe, when Patterson and Robeson were talking about the lack of democracy beyond the Cotton Curtain in Mississippi, Alabama, etc. And it was this contradiction, of course, that the United States could not escape and helped to lead directly to the diminution, if not the elimination, of Jim Crow. I believe my time is, how much time do I have left?
Well, I guess, well,
no,
I was
you're
so
taking my time, Angela, come on.
Summarize, I was so fascinated, I lost time, all right. Track of the time. Summarize.
Okay, all right, let me move to, I'll skip over a few points and just have a, I'm sure Jack O'Dell would deal with the contemporary period, so I didn't spend too much time talking about the contemporary period, but let me just make a few points. The invasion of Grenada, the criminal invasion of Grenada in 1983, was difficult, understandably, based upon what I've already said, to find any credible black lead organization that endorsed this invasion. Similarly, with the bombing of Libya, and the attempt to assassinate Gaddafi, the arms race, etc. The Rainbow Coalition, the Congressional Black Caucus, are just the latest expressions of this progressive sentiment within the Afro-American community. And indeed, I think it's not unfair to say, and this ties into Angela's comments about this very worthwhile historic conference we're participating in. Nevertheless, any movement against anti-communism or for social progress, by its very nature, has to include a disproportionate number of Afro-Americans and other national minorities, I might add, if not being led by such groups. One more point, perhaps we can take this up on questions and answers, because it's rather involved. It seems to me, as we look into the future and contemplate the future of anti-communism and the future of racism, one factor that may be taken into account, if you want to look at the world optimistically, is perhaps the impending decline of the material basis for white supremacy. It's going to be very difficult to speak of white supremacy, as we have spoken of it seems to me, when the capitalist world is going to be led by non-white people, i.e. the East Asians, as the baton of the capitalist world moves from New York to Tokyo. Indeed, in teaching a number of white students over the years, which is one of the things that I've done, I found it very curious that if you talk to them about the slave trade and Kampuchea and another Holocaust that have taken place around the globe, you know, they sort of, you know, they fall asleep, you know, et cetera. But when you begin to talk about recent reports from the Tokyo press about whites and Europeans being subjected to discrimination and not being allowed into Tokyo bars, people complaining about their body odor and other sorts of racist allegations that Afro-Americans have become quite familiar with, you know, become quite incensed and outraged. So that's one factor. And then, of course, there's a demographic factor in the United States, that with the minorities becoming an increasing percentage of the U.S. population, the U.S. has to once again try to find its way around that traditional contradiction between consumption and production, with the a significant percentage of the population not having the capital to consume what's being produced, but also not having the skills to propel a complex economy, which is why Presidents Carter and Ford, in their recent report, One Third of a Nation, pleaded to their ruling class compatriots to start vigorously, more vigorously pursuing affirmative action, which is why you have Felix Roerton in New York trying to encourage businessmen to have a doctor-school program, particularly in Harlem and other national minority communities. So it seems to me that, you know, these forces are, on the one hand, are going to be coming into conflict and contradiction with the traditional forces of racism. Racism as a source of super profit, as a useful tool for political division, and as a useful socio-psychological tool as well, and having certain people feel they're better than other people, despite massive evidence to the contrary. So I'll stop there, and perhaps we can, on question and answer, can get into this a bit more.
Jack O'Dell now will respond and sort of provide ideas to us that would lead up to the discussion.
All right, thank you. There's a lot to respond to, because this is a rather large topic in terms of its historical development, and because our two presenters, Professor Gilliam and Professor Horne, have covered a lot of territory in a rather concise way. So I want to just respond and elaborate a couple of things, and I will not take a lot of time. Angela Gilliam's point about the centrality of racism and Gerald Horne's contribution on dealing with the historical role of the left in fact and the way the literature of our country has dealt with that, and the fact that this experience with the left by the African-American community was certainly a background experience that made them less responsive to accepting anti-communism as a belief system that was being promoted by the government. Is something that we should kind of sink our teeth into. I think it's important in this regard to recognize that racism in the United States and in its intellectual development is very developed. While the common myth is that it is the white poor who've been the carriers of this ideology, the fact is that racism as an intellectual rationale was the main thesis in the social sciences of the United States from the period after the Civil War down to the First World War. It took the form of the Teutonic Origins thesis, which promulgated the idea that only those nations and peoples who could trace their origins to the Teutonic forests of Europe had the innate capacity to rule, and all others who did not have that ethnic background should be quite content to have those that did have it rule them. Now, this was a period when the African continent was being dismembered among the European powers at the Berlin Conference of 1884. And so racism and the Western Alliance have a symbiotic existence. The Teutonic Origins thesis, the headquarters was in England was Oxford University. In German, it was Göttingen. And in the United States, it was Harvard. And the political science departments of these schools, as well as the sociology departments, were the chief promoters of this. So racism has a centrality in the intellectual life of the United States. And because of that, when the intellectual life is being remolded to fit the anti-communist premise, They did not leave the racism outside. They brought the whole proposition forward. Now, there were some references to some current things that were going on, or at least they could be made current. The genocide petition of the United Nations passed 40 years ago, the covenant against genocide was only adopted this year by the United States Senate. Now, this is a nation who, under the rubric of anti-communism, has been taking freedom to the world. That was dressed up in freedom and democracy to the colored peoples of the world in particular. But this nation, 97 countries had signed, ratified this petition before the United States. Well, that is indicative of something. There was an earlier reference to, in Professor Gilliam's remarks about our history and the role of racism in our history, going back to the Indians and so forth. A recent firing line debate between William Buckley and some conservatives on the one hand and Jesse Jackson and Gene Kirkpatrick on the other, on this was leading up to the elections, who can best run the country? And you know, one side was saying the liberals could, and the other side was saying the conservatives. But it was very interesting to me that in the closing remarks, in summary, they asked each of the people on the conservative side, as they did the so-called liberal, to summarize. And Gene Kirkpatrick's summary was that, quote, we cannot accept their interpretation of the American experience. And in this instance, the there had become the liberals, which of course includes the blacks, because black, just on that occasion, was representing the liberal proposition. So my point is that these assumptions are being defended to this day. And our adversaries are very clear on that. They will not accept a different interpretation of the American experience that runs contrary to the mythologies. Professor Gilliam's presentation mentioned the significant strength of the pro-slavery forces in the period 1848 in the Congress. Well, as significant as their strength was, I think the lessons for us is to make an examination of the strength of the pro-military industrial complex forces in the Congress today. Because those are the two historical references that have to do with preserving the Constitution. The slavery forces threatened our Constitution in the 1840s through 1860 and brought on a civil war. And if you measure their material investment in preserving slavery, the export of cotton at that time accounted to about, it was the single largest export of the United States, and it earned about 40% of the revenues from exports of the American economy. But their investment was considerably smaller than the investment of the military capitalists today who are part of the military industrial complex. And it is they and their shadow government that threaten democracy today. So we should not lose sight of the fact that the slaveocracy brought on a civil war in order to defend their interests. And without attempting to say that history repeats itself in every detail, we ought to at least recognize that the dismantling of the military-industrial complex, which would be the central responsibility of any government of the people, by the people, and for the people, is likely to face very serious resistance. And I think the comments today in the panel on the national security state gave us some evidence in that regard. Now, finally, in reference to the impact of anti-communism on the African-American community, I want to underscore a couple of things. First of all, and this has to do with interpretation, based on evidence, the foreign policy of the United States has historically been racist, beginning with the violations of the sovereign rights of the Indian nations, genocide against them, all the way down to World War II, the Japanese internment, the attempt to bomb Vietnam into the Stone Age, the turning loose the atomic bomb on Hiroshima, the offering of atomic weapons to President Schumann at the time of Dien Bien Phu to the French. So it was natural for that community that historically struggled against racism to have some sense of what was the international dimensions of that struggle. The struggle against this dimension of racism in the national life and culture of the United States was logical and necessary and continues to be. Secondly, some African American leaders have helped all Americans understand their self-interest in getting involved in changing U.S. foreign policy. When Martin Luther King said that the hopes of the poor are being shot down in the rice paddies of Vietnam, well, he didn't say poor blacks, but blacks are certainly among the poor, but the poor are more than just black. Most poor people in this country are white. The question is, identifying with this truth. When Martin Luther King in his Riverside Church speech said, the American government is the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today. Well, that was before the introduction of the epidemic of drugs. And so what has changed? Now, when Malcolm was killed, and we tried to relate that to opening up the floodgates of drugs into Harlem, they said, well, it's a black issue. Now the U.S. Congress says there's 30 million drug addicts in our country, and it is tied to the foreign policy. The introduction of drugs is a dimension of aid to the Contras. When Martin Luther King said, true compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar, it is in recognizing that a system that produces beggars needs restructuring. I would think that that would register profoundly with the homeless in our streets, with the brothers and sisters who face permanent unemployment from the plant closings, and so forth. So we are in a struggle to close the gap in a certain class understanding that the black community has. And when Professor Gilliam uses these examples of Keyes and the black man in Virginia, you see, the black community has a racial identity and a class identity. If it was just race they were concerned with, they would have voted for Keyes. But they didn't trust the ticket Keyes is on. They didn't believe he could serve them within that framework. So they voted their class interests. And this community comes closest to having class consciousness than any other sector of the U.S. population. That is the, that in a certain sense is the bottom line. So I think that this question of the centrality of racism in understanding U.S. foreign policy is critical. And when I say we're trying to close the gap, it is because we have the challenge to get our potential allies in the white community voting as consistently progressive as the African-American community votes. We have not, as two communities, supported the same presidential candidate but once in the last 35 years. Now, one could argue that the common trap we have is with lesser evil, but there's some intelligence in voting for the lesser evil rather than voting for the more evil. I mean, the social ruin that we are witnessing today, which I might add is designed to continue, especially in this decade, is a direct product of government policy and who it was serving. This William Bennett, who was the former Secretary of Education, was on a program the other day, Nightline, one of those, and he was asked, well, sum up the victory now. What does that mean, that now that Bush is elected? He said it means that the Reagan policy will continue. That is the point as we sit here. The Reagan policy will continue. And until we build, now it's not going to continue because of the black community, because in the last three elections, the African-American community voted 88% against this policy. Reagan would have been a dog catcher left to the black community. So this behavior that blinds people to understanding their self-interest has become dangerous, has become exceedingly dangerous. It means that a candidate can wrap himself in the flag, solicit the support of the police departments around the country, formally, declare himself a patriot, and anybody that's liberal not, declare that his opponent is a card-carrying member of the ACLU, while he is a card-carrying member of the National Rifle Association. And the fact that this person's background, who was elected, was not a deterrent to millions of white people voting for him is a profound problem for the nation and for the world. We're not saying that 49 million white people voted for Reagan, voted for Bush because he had been a member, head of the CIA. We're saying the fact that he had been head of the CIA did not deter them from voting for him.
Okay. We would like to open it to questions, and I think the room is small enough so that you can shout your question if you're in the back, or if you have a soft voice, could you come use one of the mics?
Yeah, I wanted to, well, first of all, I feel like one of the foundations that this conference needs to be based on is their interrelationship between racism and anti-communism. And that hasn't been explored a whole lot during this conference. It's been talked about and mentioned. What I wanted to ask the panel to respond to is to talk about a little bit more is this relationship. Because it seems to me like on the one hand, we have a U.S. government, which has historically had very has used these two things against, you know, the U.S. population and against people around the world. But on the other hand, we have a progressive movement that, in my opinion at least, also uses these things. So you see, like, for instance, a lot of the solidarity with Nicaragua. See a lot of anti-communism, but also you see a lot of racism, you know, within that movement. And to be real specific about what I'm trying to talk about, a lot of the solidarity work that goes on talks on the one hand about those poor people in Nicaragua or El Salvador or wherever, you know, they can't keep, you know, keep this stuff together and they need our help. Where on the other side, they duck the fact or they duck the charge of communism all the time. Not saying that the Nicaraguan people have the right to choose who they want to be, whether it's communist or not, and that Thomas Borja is a communist, he's proud of it. But it's like, oh no, you know, they back up a bit much. So I think it's in, you know, a lot of times within that movement, those two things come together. And I think that it would be good if we could talk a little bit more about it, because I really feel, as I started out with, that one of the foundations of this conference needed to be the intersection between anti-communism and racism.
Well, by bringing up a concrete case study, I see you want to get serious. No, I mean, I agree with you, and I think that there are even more problems and issues. And I, to tell you quite frankly, I think this is such an important subject that I don't think that that it can even be touched on today or really in depth. I mean, I'm thinking, for example, also that there is a kind of an appropriation by some solidarity groups of the Central American, I mean, I just run away from New York, so I'm using that as my reference, of the Central American quote-unquote issue, and you can't get the same population to support anti-apartheid work, okay? Even though the policy against Angola and the policy against Nicaragua, this low-intensity conflict, is virtually identical in many ways. But it's, I think that this whole question of the anti-communism and anti-Sovietism, I would have liked to have seen something about the effect that Glasnost would have on some of the problems of the intersection of, you know, racism and anti-communism in terms of just how solidarity movements function and so on. I mean, there are many issues that you're raising, where they come up. You know, the intersection of anti-communism and racism. I think of Charlene Mitchell, who is not only a member of the Communist Party, but also the National Alliance Against Racism and Political Repression. And she says that, you know, our task is to understand that racism is used to fight communism and that anti-communism is used to fight the struggle against equality. And until the continual merger takes place, you know, we're really not going to address the problem. And in a sense, the this whole issue of how Afro-Americans view the anti-apartheid movement and the fact that likewise sometimes we can't make the logical step to also understanding that what happens in Honduras, especially since there's so many Afro-American and Hispanic American servicemen in Honduras and what that is doing to the black Honduran, you know, the black Carib or the Garifuna Honduran communities. I mean, there's a lot of information that is just not there, and that really maybe that has to be a conference in and of itself. I mentioned the right-wing church business and that how that affects, for example, Armageddon theory. And when Jane Power and I were in the Middle East together on a women's delegation to the West Bank and Gaza and Israel, we learned that a lot of black American groups, for example, go to Israel in huge groups, church groups, right? Continually to visit. And of course, Armageddon theory that merges Gog, meaning the United States, Gog, Magog, United Soviet Union. Gog and Magog are going to come to a nuclear war in the land of Israel, and Magog, the Soviet Union, is going to use the armies of Africa against Gog. You know, this ideology is a part of anti-communism also, and it is also a part of the ideology that, for example, a lot of Americans, black and white, are susceptible to, and we haven't really addressed this too. And I think that while it's important to look at the issue of McCarthyism, for example, there's so many issues this side of McCarthyism that we haven't, that we really don't know how to, for example, address. That perhaps this is, I think one of the good things about this conference is that it's shown that there is a real market, quote unquote, for this, for addressing this kind of issue. And perhaps what we need to do is to take it all over the country, including some just centered on this issue of, let's say, anti-communism and the Afro-American experience, or the Afro-American attempt to influence foreign policy, right? Gerald, do you want to add to it?
No, I'll pass.
No, I would like to respond to it as well. We have in the Rainbow Coalition, attempted to bridge these questions of the two movements, solidarity, Central America and Southern Africa, around the contra aid issue. And our theme is contra aid is contra aid. And if you pose contra aid, contra aid as public policy is what must be opposed. So people focusing on Central America as if that's the only contra aid, no, support for Renamo in Mozambique and in UNITA in Angola, that's contra aid. So we have found people coming together around that understanding that contra aid as public policy must be opposed. And I think that this, we began to crystallize this immediately after the march on Washington in spring of 1987, where the issue of Southern Africa and Central America were issues of that march. But I think that we need to find those particular types of issues that enable people that have different focus of agenda to see the commonality of what they're doing, because we still live in a specialized culture and people tend to focus on their thing. And I'm not ascribing all that to racism either. I mean, people in Central America, you know, the Central America Solidarity Movement, they're struggling. I mean, they're struggling to change U.S. policy in relation to Central America. And given the fact that, you know, I mean, there's just so much time you have and just so much energy. And the same thing in the Southern Africa thing. Those brothers and sisters are struggling against apartheid and whatever, and they don't. But the point is, how do they intersect? They intersect in this issue around contra aid as public policy. And when we link the fact that that contra aid is an extension in Southern Africa of the apartheid regime's strategy, you begin to pull quite a few forces together to see each other's agenda. And once that starts to happen, everybody grows.
Another question? One, two.
I wonder if you could speak more, Jack, about the role of the Third World Caucus in Sane Freeze and the influence it's had and the influence in U.S. foreign policy through that whole effort over the last couple years.
Repeat the question, please.
The role of the Third World Caucus in Sane Freeze. Well, I want to be brief on this, although it's a very significant area. As you know, the two organizations have merged, and then that merger is still part of a struggle. The Third World Caucus has attempted to provide a certain direction to the merger process, because we knew that just bigness didn't make things better. We had the historic example of the AFL-CIO that merged, you know, and you didn't come out with a more progressive CIO. you came out with a more backward organization politically, and the progressive forces were shunted off into the industrial union department and so forth. Well, so the Third World Caucus in Sane Freeze has attempted to keep the new merged organization on a progressive course. That is, everybody recognizes that by the merger, potentially, this organization had greater possibility for influencing public policy in the area of disarmament and anti-intervention. But we also knew that the focus of certain forces like in Freeze just on being a single issue meant that the whole organization might fall into that trap. There's been great resistance in the Freeze, for example, to deal with any of the movements or related to any of the movements that are dealing with the impact of the arms race. You know, and it is that dimension that the Third World Caucus has attempted to influence, that people who are struggling against the cuts in housing and food stamps on unemployed and the plant closing movements are objectively in a peace struggle. They're in a struggle against the effects of the arms race, not just in a struggle for the abolition of certain weapons of the arms race. And so these forces have to see each other in their relationship to each other. And that has been generally the role of the Third World Caucus in attempting to direct the Sane Freeze merger in this direction. And I might add to that, in addition, we have had some discussions like this on the role of racism, if nothing more than to influence the affirmative action policy of the Sane Freeze merged organization. Because, you know, it's very easy to hire and the blacks and Hispanics be the invisible men and women, even while you give lip service to the fact that you believe in equality and so forth. Every organization that is multiracial has to address the problem of racism because it's born in America. So we bring the habits and the assumptions, even unconsciously, that we inherit from the larger society and culture into the organization we're in. Whether you're talking about the trade union movement, the peace movement, the mass movement, plant closing, whatever. Where we are attempting to build a movement of the people of the United States, the struggle against racism has to be carried forward with vigor, or that attempt will fail.
Question number two.
I too concur with the brother and previous speakers about the conference. And since I noticed that you sit on the board of the Institute, I think that really has to be a necessary follow-up and certainly part of the evaluation, which all of us should indicate. That's why every question we ask is, of course, enormous, because we're trying to put it into so small a space. I just want to point out, in following up on what Jack said, that I met April 27th, last year, 87, was one of the most remarkable demonstrations precisely because it dealt with the convergence of our national security state and terrorist policies against the Contras in Central America and supporting the Contras in Central America and Southern Africa. It was the first time you saw a demonstration that had such an enormous outpouring of all people of color. But asking a kind of enormous question, and also maybe an organizing strategy. One of the things that concerns me, and it was mentioned in certainly the Women's Conference, is that in building this national security state and using the racism and anti-communism and so on, we are deliberately erasing historic memory. I mean, I know that I have to struggle. I never got this in my textbooks. You will not see it, by the way, I think wittingly, I don't know if I misheard you, but wittingly in the media. Are they erasing from our memory these kinds of important struggles that you've only alluded to? My children certainly aren't getting it in their textbooks, except by struggle, if they happen to fall upon now progressive professors. And I think that's a very important strategy that we have to begin, or a problem, epidemic that we have to address. And I wondered if you might comment on it and on what vehicles, you know, might need to.
Well, that is a large question. Because it's a merger of two issues, and I think it came up yesterday in one of the panels on independent politics, that the question of the media and the transmission to succeeding, well, education in a sense is transmission to succeeding generations of the information that the ruling class deems should be passed on, right? A la Jean Kirkpatrick, right. Whereas in the media, we get this day-to-day interpretation of what's going on around us, not so much the historical analysis as much as a horizontal analysis of our life. And this, of course, I think I heard reference to a military-industrial media complex. Somebody said that Jack invented that term. But I think that that's a really appropriate term, because in a sense the media and the military have joined forces to become the fourth arm of government that is not accountable by vote to the American people. I mean, in a sense that really is what happened. So when you look at the last election and you see how, let's say, George Bush, as I like to put it, used, and his ilk used the American flag like a jockstrap. There wasn't really any kind of opposition anywhere in the media, and you hear people complaining and talking about it, but there isn't any opposition to, any organized opposition really that has any impact to the media as it is now. And I think the biggest success of this complex has been to convince the vast majority of American people, including many progressives, that we have some kind of freedom of information. To me, that has been the most successful propaganda. And the reason why I say including many progressives, I sat in on a constitutional discussion with Nicaraguan judges and lawyers who came up with a lot of progressive lawyers who were participating in this constitutional discussion. And I was amazed at how much a lot of lawyers had bought into the freedoms guaranteed by the Constitution, and we just have to live up to them. And if we really look at the history of the United States, we see that the ruling class, in essence, took away from working people the principles of the Declaration of Independence. And until we really kind of address the origins of our country, I really don't think we're going to address the whole question of militarism, because anti-communism is militarism par excellence. Gus?
Could I just have a little comment on this memory thing? The types of meeting like this, and even on a smaller scale, are critical. We must proliferate the information. And there are pieces of information that symbolize the connection between racism and anti-communism. And one of them is that the architects of the Cold War were Southern segregationists. James Eastland of Mississippi, head of the Senate Internal Security Committee. James Burns, Secretary of State, was the architect of the Cold War. Tom Clark of Texas devised the Attorney General's list of subversives to which citizens have to defend themselves. The history of the Cold War in its origins, the architects were Southern segregationist politicians who wouldn't have been in office if the black community had had the franchise. That's very critical.
I wondered how we could pursue a truthful analysis, both intellectually and practically, of the actions of ethnic groups on voting from a class perspective versus a tribal perspective. And I say that because historically the sociologists and other people have talked about the apathy of black people, i.e. politics in this particular country, but I dare say since the development of the rainbow in 1983, we've seen with the upsurge in registration and participation And just based on the analysis that Jack just laid out there, we in fact have voted from a class perspective, whereas white people in general, you know, the master race, some people would say whatever else, have voted from a totally different perspective. And in effect, that says something about the nature of working class and poor whites who have been duped into pursuing that which is not in their best interest. How do we some way assess this and exploit this? I mean, we can even say it's true to Jews and Israelis too, who pursue the present policies in Israel, which are gonna come full circle and eventually come down on their heads based on what I saw as recently as August when I was in the West Bank in Gaza. And yet and still the historians, the political scientists, the sociologists, and other people continuously report missed facts on this. I'm talking about those who are relative from a tribal standpoint. And I just wonder, as a somebody who somewhat is concerned, as well as everybody in here, how we begin to exploit that and get at the heart of that.
Well, let me just put a brief fine point on this.
If I recall correctly, union households voted differently in general in the 1984 election than the U.S. populace as a whole. That is to say, they voted more against Reagan, say, than non-union households. According to an L.A. Times CNN post-election poll that was in the L.A. Times the day after the election, Dukakis not only won the women's vote, but he also won the vote of non-high school graduate vote. He won the under $20,000 a year vote, not to mention the black vote. So I think
that's a little voting.
Yeah. So I mean, I think we have to put a fine point on the point that you're making. I mean, you know, I'll turn the floor over to Angela, because who I think has something to say. But I think that, you know, the next 18 months in this country are going to be very interesting, because it's a little question that a recession is coming.
If I may, let me say something out there, because much of what went into the running of the Trump campaign was the analysis of the voting patterns in the 19th century and the 20th century. 80% of all those eligible to vote in the 19th century voted, but of course, that was only white males. They were the only people who were registered to vote then. They compared that to the same population in this century, and that was 77%. So they looked at women, people of color, and everybody else, and took them for granted, something like 38%. But they failed to look at the Carter voting patterns, when in fact people were really speaking to those issues. How do we then bring this whole thing out to exploit it so that we can't permit the Democrat Party to do what it did again, you know, so that they wouldn't have to respond to the so-called Jackson forces and whatever else, when in fact the Jackson forces and people in that particular camp who did decide to vote, voted class and whatever else, how do we work in that best interest?
See, this is a really complicated question, because, and I think there's some varying interpretations to what happened, and still all of the statistics aren't out, but of the 11 states that Dukakis won, 8 of the 11 had 4% or less black people. Okay. With the 8 of the 11, so like New York and District of Columbia accepted, of course. In those states, that's where women voted, I mean, put Dukakis over. It clearly, the women's vote was critical. It is in the old Confederacy that women voted pretty much the same, white women that is, pretty much the same way as white men, that is for Bush. And this is, of course, the bastion of the religious right and a lot of this old Confederacy. And I really hate this term conservative, because it is masking, as I think somebody said, the real, what is really at the bottom of being a conservative.
Well,
you know, it is. Right, exactly. But it's not just black people. The Institute for Puerto Rican Policy in New York, after the primary, in which, because there was a Puerto Rican running for attorney general, not attorney general, what is it, U.S. state attorney or something, I can't remember the exact, Robert Johnson is the first black in the history of the state to win this election, but during
district attorney, in the primary,
there was a Puerto Rican, there was this black person, Robert Johnson. And the editorials were commenting, well, Puerto Ricans just are really the most, you know, they didn't understand they should have come out to have voted for this, their candidate. So the Institute for Puerto Rican Policy pointed out in their study, Puerto Ricans voted, they just didn't vote for Diaz because he was recognized as being a lackey of the current Koch corruption. They voted for Johnson, okay? So also in Texas, California, New Mexico, Mexicans, Latinos of Mexican origin rather, Chicanos voted more for Dukakis than they even voted in 84. It was 72% or 75% voted for Mondale in 84, but 82% voted for Dukakis. In Texas, California, brown baby grandchildren notwithstanding, right? And so all the questions, according to the Southwest voter research on this, is that they voted more, he put it, economic issues, but that's class, okay? So that I'm sure we could find that pattern reproduced with Native Americans, with, you know, with a lot of different peoples. I think one of the problems is that we don't really have a place or some kind of central way of looking at the, you know, linking all of this data and putting it together and saying, look, folks, this is the situation. You put a candidate, you know, the ruling cabal of the Democratic Party would prefer to lose to a Republican than to let the people, in essence, win. And I think that this is the second time that that has happened.
I'm going to shut up, but I'm on Tuesday further.
Okay, I see two questions up there.
Right. As we talk about the class status, because we recognize by then pursuing and putting the right people in there, we would have an impact on that. We talked about where we go tomorrow, and we looked at yesterday. Now they're going to foreclose on 80,000 farmers. Right. The sweatshops that just come out and whatever else. It seems like, from the rainbow perspective and the progressive perspective, we should be marching tomorrow to organize and make them people aware of the relativity of their problems, and that's how we start making those connections and developing them.
There are two questions, the gentleman and then Benny after.
My question is related to some overall situation with the whole conference, but I'll ask it here. Has there been or is there presently or has there been historically any legitimate criticism of anti-communism by African Americans? And if so, when we add that to the totality of the black and red experience in this country, what kind of conclusions do we come up with, even in domestic or foreign policy?
My response is, the first part, I'm not sure of the import, what you mean by the second part, perhaps you may want to clarify that. But certainly, I mean, Du Bois, Robeson, William Patterson, I mean, the list is endless in terms of Afro-Americans who've done a critique of anti-communism. Charlotta Bass, Angela Davis, you know.
Well, I guess what I mean by when I say legitimate criticism of anti-communism, criticism of communism.
Oh, you said criticism of communism?
Criticism of communism that's legitimate.
Oh, I thought you said criticism of anti-communism.
Has there been that in the African-American?
Criticism of communism.
I suppose that's a general question for this whole conference, but has there been legitimate criticism of communism by African Americans historically or contemporarily? And how does that affect the totality of our understanding of the black and red experience in this country, either with regard to foreign policy or domestic policy, domestic struggles?
I'm not sure if I understand the question, because I mean legitimate criticism of communism. I'm not sure what a legitimate criticism.
Well, the whole conference has been that all criticism of communism is somehow illegitimate. That's the feeling I've been getting. I'm wondering out loud at this point, is there such a thing as legitimate criticism of anti-communism?
Oh, that's interesting. It's just like this. It's like look at something. Let me reason by analogy. Racism, anti-Semitism really doesn't have that much to do with any actual or alleged failings of Jewish people. I mean, it's an ideology that stands alone that's really not, that, just like racism, has little to do with whether or not a person is mugged by a black youth, you see. I mean, there's an ideology that stands separate and apart. Similarly, I would say that anti-communism as an ideology has not that much to do with pre-perestroika, pre-glasnost Soviet Union, quite frankly. It has little or nothing to do, if they would be, these people were so concerned about the, you know, the poor peasants and the poor kulaks and the Ukraine, well, why haven't they expressed, these same elites expressed similar concern about the slave trade that brought some of us here in the first place, or about what's going on in Southern Africa, et cetera. So, you know, it's difficult for me to confront the question because I guess I'm not in tune with the premises of the question.
Well, give him some names, Gerald. Give the man some names.
Name
George Schuyler.
Oh,
Ralph Ellison.
Of course, all right. I don't consider that, as I said, the question, there's an adjective that says legitimate. I mean, yeah. George Schuyler, yeah, you can go read George Schuyler, Black and Conservative, it's a very interesting memoir. He wrote for the Pittsburgh Courier for decades, one of the most staunch right-wing.
Yeah.
George Schuyler, he was an idiot.
Okay.
No question about it.
Well,
the village idiot.
I want to say something about this, though. See, I think your question presupposes that there was an objective, rational condition we were living in which people could be objective about two systems being compared. All black leadership that's progressive has been in favor of a critique of world systems, if you will, to see which one would be the best one for solving problems. But now, how do you critique the Soviet Union when you couldn't get a passport to travel? How do you critique except by a bookish approach, you know, what Marx said or didn't say, when in fact, to know something about a socialist country is to be suspect of being subversive. In other words, we haven't been living in an objective environment in which a rational discourse on the question of communism versus some other system was allowed. We have been immersed in an anti-communist one that got its roots, I might add, if you're talking about memory, from Hitler Germany. I mean, you know, the premises of anti-communism in the United States are the same premises of all fascist states. And that is that there is a menace called the Soviet Union, that any change in the world is somehow a product of a conspiracy centered in Moscow, and therefore, to work to change anything in your own country, you are actually the agent of a foreign power. In fact, when they locked up Dr. Du Bois for circulating the petition of the Stockholm Peace Appeal that would call for ending all nuclear weapons by renouncing nuclear weapons, the charge of the State Department in that indictment was that he was the agent of a foreign principal.
Fanny, you have a question? And then a question?
On this very I think one has to see that anti-communism is part of a power play, that is, the United States seeks hegemony, power, and anti-communism can be used as a means, which doesn't have anything to do with what it substantively means. And so it must be seen in terms of an attempt to extend its power.
And it also takes religious kind of discussion.
And then one needs to question whether that hegemony makes sense. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the question.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Fanny, and then
what is he? I might understand him because I'm sitting back here. what I understand him to be saying is that the premise of the conference is that anti-communism is a bad thing. And I think he's questioning whether or not there may not be some legitimate critiques of communism. Is that what you're saying?
Relative to time and period and to where you're at, because I wasn't talking about the Soviet Union, I was talking more about the domestic experience.
Okay, that's
African American.
Yeah.
I'm sure
it's
a relative question.
Okay, and I think that's real important, you know, that we're missing something if there are people.
Okay, well, let me just address how, in a sense, the question. I mean, I've done a lot of research. research and have written about, for example, the total merger of this paradigm in, as Jack was mentioning, social science, definitions of development, how those definitions of development are applied to third world people, are applied right here at home. In other words, I think that our culture, that is, that aspect of American life which we absorb consciously and unconsciously, is imbued with a notion that demonizes and that satanizes any opposition to capitalism. Okay? This demonization takes a simplistic form in terms of calling the Soviets the sponsors of all kinds of cries for equality at one level, okay? I think of Isabella Tellier, whose husband was killed in Washington by a Chilean fascist who was somehow gotten to the United States. And she said, we don't need the Soviets to tell the Cubans to tell us there is something wrong in Chile. And I think many third world or first world or whatever, many people, working people in the world, essentially would say the same thing. Now, in the process of looking at these struggles for access to the resources, right, and another definition of development, in the process of all of this, I think what has come about is that black people have put forth an agenda together with other people, progressive people, and so on. But the opposition to this struggle for equality is usually framed within this context of satanizing any opposition to the status quo. Now, that is essentially how I view anti-communism, as a religious paradigm that is culturally transmitted in the textbooks, in the newspapers, in the culture. And therefore, going back to what Jack was saying, to sort of stand back after I've come back from Cuba, for example, and to sort of say, well, on the one, to students in a class, well, on the one hand, the Cubans, there's nobody picking up garbage. There are no bag people at all in Cuba anywhere. But on the other hand, you see that some of Cuban youth are sort of yuppie-like because they've had all of these, they've had their material life guaranteed. Most Americans don't even know how to handle that on the one hand, on the other hand, discussion, because they are framing it within a religious context that anti-communism, of anti-communism. So I think that's one of the...
Let me respond also. Can I respond? I mean, if all that is wanted are bibliographic references, that some of Afro-Americans who've done critiques of communism, I can provide those. Andrea Lee, for example, the young Afro-American woman did her, I think it was called Russian Diary or something like that. Yeah. Thomas Sowell, Bayard Rustin, Colin Powell, Robert Johnson's Black Man in Red Russia, Carlos Moore, who's done, you know. Now, some people consider those to be legitimate. If you want my opinion, I consider them all to be illegitimate. But yes, there have been black people who have done critiques of communism, critiques of socialism, many in an anti-communist vein.
My point, you just ran off some names and you said they were all illegitimate.
Well, in my opinion, you're asking me my... No. Ideologically speaking, no. Okay.
Well, wait. Because this lady had her hand up for a long time, and I'll come back to you because I thought that was your question.
Excuse me, mine isn't going to take but a minute because I don't want to interrupt this discussion, which I think is very important. It's not a question. I just wanted to let people know that we have a pamphlet here in which Jack O'Dell expands on many of the ideas that he said here now, called The Human History of the Human Costs of the Cold War, which I think is the best short history of the Cold War that's in print. And I brought some over from the literature room and to put here so people could get them as they go out. And I urge you to get this and read it and take it home and have other people read it. And if we don't have enough here, they are over in the literature room. So thank you, I just wanted to make that
mention.
Are
you giving them away or the
free? How much does it cost? Oh, $1.
Okay.
I promise to come back to Fanny and then Sydney. Fanny, Sydney, and this gentleman here.
I'm going to follow up on two things that you said, if I may. As part of this concept of anti-communism that has largely focused on the role of the state throughout this conference and neglected to a large degree a lot of the ideological manipulation of the media and other sources of information in the society. Can you hear me?
Louder.
I'm sorry. And if I could, one of the things that you were doing, Angela, was to talk about the way these ideas are internalized. And I think what is so very significant about what we see every day is the way that the other is consistently demonized in every sphere of our lives. Whether or not we call the demon anti-communism or whether or not the demon is not specifically labeled. And if I could, I'd like to give an example of what happened in Chicago several weeks ago. There had been a series of gang killings in which very young people had lost their lives, people 13, 14 years old, followed by an incident in which someone had been driving a car, lost control of the car, and the car careened into a school in a Latino neighborhood, injuring about 20 children and killing one of them. A few weeks later, and this made nationwide news, a young, mentally disturbed white woman went into a North Shore suburb, into a school, and went on a shooting spree. Television was totally suspended that day with the coverage of the Lori Dan case. The news media kept saying things like, the North Shore is very upset about this because this is one of their own. These things do not happen here. Consistently, the coverage was such that regular programming had to be interrupted to cover this. When 14 and 15-year-old black and Latino boys had been shot in the street, television coverage was not interrupted. When the children were injured in the Latino school and one killed, television coverage was not interrupted. And so it is a constant kind of elevating of the pain, and certainly I'm not advocating people shooting children. What I'm saying is that it is an elevating of the pain of the dominant group and a denigrating of the pain of people who are not part of the dominant group, so that this demonization of the other is constant, and so it is very easy then to enlarge that to both national and international events. And the other thing that I'd like to just talk about briefly is the fact that the last election, if nothing else, has revealed to people the total bankruptcy of both the Republican and the Democratic Party, which many people responded to, rightly or wrongly, for not voting. So the important question then for a conference such as this, it seems as though to me, is can the left provide a viable alternative for people? And if so, does the left itself not have to address a fundamental question of racism which has consistently inhibited its development as a viable alternative within the United States?
Jack, since you're...
Well, can the left provide an alternative? I would say yes. Part of that process is underway with the formation of the National Rainbow Coalition. Must it conduct a relentless struggle against racism? Absolutely, because the crystallizing of this moral political force in the country, capable of turning the country around, will not be achieved except for the struggle against racism, because racism is an obstacle to people seeing their identity of interest in terms of making some changes. And so the struggle against racism is central to the success of this effort and all other efforts that correspond to it to create a viable political force that would be a dual authority in the country, capable of competing for the public mind and eventually winning a majority and getting a people's government. Absolutely.
Then we have mm-hmm. got to do something so that when we look around the audience of this conference, that the conference is not white, and that the conference is not ninety percent of anything, but is indeed truly representative of, and not, you know, not as a peripheral issue, but the struggle for labor in this country has always been the struggle over the labor of non-white people. Therefore, this struggle has to be central to the organizing of a conference around anti-communism. And I'm a little bit troubled because I see that being highly peripheralized in this conference.
Could I ask you a question about that? You mean there is a lack of participation of sections of the labor movement in the conference?
I'm talking about there's a lack of participation on the part of the labor movement, on the part of non-white people in this society. Look around you. I mean, I know just about every black person here, you know, and I don't think I know all the black people in the United States. There is a striking absence of Latino people of every stripe in this conference. There is a striking absence of Native people in this conference, and yet it is the labor of blacks, of Latinos, and of Native people that have not only built this country, but have always consistently forced the struggle for democracy in this country. And where are they in this conference? And that has to be seriously, seriously addressed, regardless of what good intentions people may or may not have had. That's not what I'm questioning. I assume that the intentions of people here are better than the intentions of most. But this is a serious, serious question of organization and whether or not the left can indeed be a viable alternative if it cannot come to grips with this. The failure of the populist movement in this country was the failure to come to grips with the question of racism, so that all of those black populists and all of those black farmers who were willing to join into the Grange movement could not do so deliberately because of the nature of racism, and people couldn't deal with that. And I'm saying that we cannot talk about the left being a viable alternative, no matter how much we would like that, until we can seriously, seriously come to grips with that. So, I mean, it's not a gratuitous question, you know, about, yes, of course we should do that. The question is, how do we really do that so that in spite of intentions, you don't end up with what we've got here this weekend?
Questions?
I mean, I think the points are well taken, but just to try to separate the issues and also in the interest of time, because I think we have to leave pretty soon. I think, you know, we have to separate the issues. On the one hand, there's the question, can the left move in a political and or electoral manner? And then on the other hand, there's this conference. You know, I mean, this conference is not necessarily, you know, the same as that first question. You know, they're two separate issues. So on the one hand, there's a critique of the conference. On the other hand, there's the question that Jack is addressing through the rain, say, for example, through the Rainbow Coalition. So I don't think we should assume maybe that the Rainbow Coalition reflects the conference, or, you know, they're separate questions we're talking about.
I would only say that I agree, Fanny, that this is a constant struggle, and only a backup, if you will, Jack O'Dell's contention that perhaps it isn't, or that the one kind of organization that has to be organized seriously, and I can't stress this enough because a lot of people are afraid about it, is something like the Rainbow. That is, that it not be something geared to an election, but that it become a way of life, and that this kind of organizing then would with the parameters of the Rainbow Coalition can absorb all kinds of people, including all of the people in this at the conference. And I think this is an important beginning, as I said earlier, but certainly it has been it has been a point that many of us have brought out, that this issue of the centrality of racism, perhaps even that has to be discussed. Is racism central to anti-communism or not? Or to the struggle against the struggle for democracy. You know what I mean? Other people think that it is something else. And so I think this is part of an ongoing dialogue that hopefully has begun, and the fact that this is on videotape is certainly part of that process. Could I have my last question up there, because we have to leave? You had your hand up?
just a response to the ongoing concern we all have as to how we can get more participation, at least locally, where conferences held from the people who live around here. Many of us invited other people, but you have to understand that there are other efforts to do this. There was a conference around Puerto Rican writers and poets at the Roxbury Community College this week. The Roxbury Multi-Service Center is having their 75th year celebration. Many black churches are part of the 50-year presence of the Negro in Boston, or the Afro-American in Boston. Because you don't always see a wide variety of participation doesn't mean that the conference in itself is inviolable. But it does mean that when you're in a session, say the one on McCarthyism, and someone responds to the role of the U.S. University in capitulating to the whole Red Scare toward professors and students, and you leave out the whole panorama of the traditionally black-run colleges who took a completely different tact, then that's the time that you speak up. And I think the other way you do it is in your fee structure. And of course, that means extra monies that everyone brings a student or brings a person who there was a fixed income rate and advertises it in ways that aren't traditional to the mailing list, that you have to talk about it and put it up at the corner grocery store, talking about it in your church or sorority. But I would not feel that the conference is a failure because everyone doesn't participate. Other people are doing this in their own ways in the community, and there's actually a quite rich response, particularly since the election and the work of the Rainbow, to people indigenously in how to change this. And I think this is an intellectual process whereby you are bringing it up, and I think the videotaping is a way for some of us to take it back.
Mm-hmm.